Are we on? There's no intro?
We are. Todd messed up the intro, so we're going to roll it now, Sean.
That sounds...
Unsyndicated presents... Off the Air with Sean Baligian.
So I know we're a little early tonight. You're going to have to excuse me. I hope you can forgive me. This is all about what up? Yo to you. This is all about me tonight. I told Todd point blank, I want to do this a little bit earlier tonight because I want to sit down and watch the Holy War. Facebook user said, hello, friend. I don't know which Facebook user it is, but hello, friend, to you as well. Hello, friend. I'm Sean. So much going on. Todd, there are certain games that I think are underrated in the college football world. And I think the Holy War is one of them. I think BYU in Utah is outstanding, especially in a year like this. If you know me at all, good evening, Sean and Todd. Hello. I wonder why it's coming up as Facebook user as opposed to their names. That's strange. That's not our fault, but I'm just going to say hi, Facebook user. And hello, friend. If you know me at all, I think one of the cool things about college football are the programs that kind of just step up and do things, right? The non-traditionals. It was hi, Facebook monkey Jason. What's up, Jason? That's so weird. It's coming up as Facebook user as opposed to Jason or whomever, Todd or Tom. I know our buddy Tom in London's probably watching his Penn State. They were up at last check. So for years, what's up, Tom? For years, I would always laugh. What's up, Nick? I would always laugh when people would take shots at Wisconsin. For years, I just thought that was a funny bit because here's, you know, whether it was Barry Alvarez or even after Barry left, here's a program that they won the conference multiple times and people would take shots at them. And it never really made sense to me. And I'll tell you point blank, what made me laugh even harder about it was the era of time where people around here in Michigan were taking shots at Wisconsin. And I used to say to my Michigan friends and Michigan State friends, hey, guys, why are you taking shots at Wisconsin? Oh, they're a fraud. They're a fraud. Okay, well, maybe on the national stage, I get it. In a lot of the big games that they played, they didn't do so well. Have to get that out there, right? But yet, the crazy thing about it, they were doing what your program and my program weren't doing for a while, which was winning the conference. And it made no sense to me. That's a great way to put it. They were big good. Whoever said that. I'm sorry. I don't know why Facebook users coming up tonight as opposed to your names. So if you guys want to write like your name after your comment, feel free. So then I know who you are. I apologize for that. That's a great comment. Whoever said Wisconsin was usually big good. That was that's a really good comment. Because they didn't win a lot of the big games on the national stage. But again, just to reiterate, I would laugh and go, wait a second. Now, I know you're a Michigan State fan, or I know you're a Michigan fan. Wait, how are you calling them a fraud when they're winning Big Ten conferences? When they're winning divisions? This was before the division, you know, and we know that side of the conference sucked. So lots going on tonight. I want to get your thoughts on Michigan. Those of you that watched the Michigan game today, it was a tough watch and it was a tough watch, made worse by the fact that if you were a Michigan fan, you probably were ticked off because that was a very winnable game in the second half. The defense shut Indiana down and kept them in the game. And more thoughts on that in a second. I have to confess, though, like I was laughing my tail off just a few minutes ago watching A, Brian Kelly lose his mind on the sideline, and B, Alabama stretch their lead to 28-6. I also have some apologies tonight, too. I always like to call myself out when I was wrong about something. Now, I'm not going to go as far as somebody suggested I go. But I do have to offer a apology. Michigan had some hope from Nick. Now a six-loss season. I thought five, but nobody saw Indiana at 9-0. Indiana's good. I know the offense kind of crapped the bed in the second half. I think Indiana's a pretty good team. How good are they? Can I use Nick's line? Big Ten good? Brian Kelly is an amazing human being. That comes from Jason. Yes. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. There are certain guys, I'm not going to lie to you, I like watching certain guys lose. I do. I'm not one that usually is that way, but when I am that way, I'm really that way, and I feel really good about watching Brian Kelly lose. My neighbor, my pal, R-Dog, in Houston for the Lions game, sent you a couple of picks. Outstanding, R-Dog. Oh, I'm looking at that right now. Oh, that's great stuff. That's fantastic. Live. Good. Enjoy yourself down there. Oh, those are... Ooh, look at you, R-Dog. You celebrity. I see you. Good stuff. Brian Kelly is one of those guys that I just root against. I just do. Sorry. I just root against him. At least Twitter can comment now. That's awesome. Alan said it was hilarious that Wink Martindale turned into Bill Belichick in the second half. Unfortunately, their OC was Matt Patricia and their quarterback was Zach Wilson. Go Lions to you as well. Skydog says, is it true that OSU people or fans are accusing Indiana of cheating? Did they? I didn't hear that one. Todd, did you hear that one? I didn't hear that. Maybe we'll look up that. All right. So before I get deep into the Michigan Indiana game, and I'd love to hear all of your thoughts. Let me finish my thoughts. So I kind of stuck up for Wisconsin for a while. Boise. Another program that deserves to be stuck up for, and they've been really good for a while, very quietly, very good, and unless you're paying attention, Utah. And I know that Utah's not having the type of season that Utah's accustomed to, but Urban Meyer got them going, and then Kyle kept them going. And the reason why we're starting tonight point blank, I am selfishly admitting to you right now, telling you right now, I want to get this done so I can go watch the Holy War. I want to watch BYU and Utah. Should be a damn good one. Very, very, very good type of thing. Shauna will need to get a valet. Brian Kelly with this talk, Facebook monkey. BQ said, thanks for doing the show, Sean. It's been a great new addition to the College Football Saturday routine. Thank you. I appreciate it. You know what? Honestly, BQ, I think there are a lot of guys like me, like you, and, you know, the guys that jump in the chat. It's a Saturday night. We're sitting at home watching college football. Some place to chat about it, you know? Try to jump all around. Must confess, I mixed in a little hockey tonight as well. But at the end of the day, that's why we're doing this show. Mike and I are going to be doing the What the Puck really soon, getting into a lot of NHL stuff. I'll still be doing some high school stuff. We have a lot of special guests coming up on What the Puck, including GW. If you're watching, we were talking about one of the guys on Facebook today. I'm going to get him on. And you are probably going to watch a grown man weep tears of joy. Todd, you don't even know this yet. All right, to those of you who remember back in the day when my favorite player ever, Larry Robinson, called me on my birthday to wish me a happy birthday, and I turned into a seven-year-old. I would say maybe my second favorite player of all time is going to come on one of our shows, which is pretty cool. You got it. You got it. Numero quidont cat. He's going to come on one of our shows. The Habs and the Wings are playing in the alumni series. Some of you guys know I've been fortunate to call those games the last couple times. First against Rangers, or excuse me, Bruins, then Rangers. Now the Habs are coming to town in February. So I'm kind of working on a few special guests, and Numero quidont cat will be one of them. And Gordy is old enough to remember a guy walking around the halls at Livonia Stevenson probably two or three times a week wearing that Stefan Risci jersey. Guy Lafleur is not still alive, unfortunately. He passed away a couple years ago. Lung cancer got him. Do you do these for the Lions as well? I'm just jumping on now for the first time. Loved you being on 96.1 with Big Drew. Oh, I had a blast with Big Drew. No, not for the Lions. I'm involved in a pregame show on Woodward, so check us out. Neil Rule and I will be on tomorrow from 6:30 to 8:30. We are going to be at Hayes Social out in Shelby Township, but certainly you can check out our pregame show. I have a blast doing that with Neil. It's a lot more fun doing that show. I had to be buttoned up when I did the TV show and had the suit on and all that stuff. I can drop F-bombs. I can do what I want in that format. So it's kind of fun. Todd said, I think the Indiana cheating thing was sarcasm. All I can find is a thread from diehard Michigan fans Facebook page saying OSU must think Indiana is cheating now. Am I not Guy Lafleur? See, you guys are getting me going. I'm going to have to tell that story. Alan said, I understand being upset at Lalonde, but at what point do you blame the roster construction? We have two competent defensemen. Our goalies have to be perfect for us to win. That's not a shot at Iserman, by the way. I've accepted that we're waiting for the kids. You pretty much nailed that, Alan. This is not a good roster. The way they've been winning is not sustainable. He's using his time-honored recipe of getting a veteran goaltender and trying to wring out as much as he can. Their PK is abysmal. It's awful. That is concerning to me. That's very concerning to me. Fastest 2 hours on the internet. Thank you, Tom. Skydog said he was the reason I liked the Habs in the 70s. Yeah, Guy was fantastic. So, as I said, I can't wait to go watch the Holy War in a couple minutes. Two apologies. I always like to be the guy that confesses when I miss something. Number one, Miami. I've been talking up Miami for months, if you've paid attention. I've been talking up Miami, and I've been talking up Cam Ward in particular, okay? For Miami to crap the bed like they did against Georgia Tech, there's no excuse for that. If you want to be one of those people that, you know, play the U is back card, have at it. And it was interesting because the signs were there. You know, they got themselves in holes. They had to bury themselves out. If you do that over and over, more often than not, it's eventually going to catch you. Period, end of story. They have no business losing that game to Georgia Tech. If you want to be considered back, if you want to be considered the number four team in the nation, okay, you go in there and find a way to win that football game. Period, end of story. And they didn't. So there's that. Now, the interesting question is, might that be Miami's only loss? Could they be playoff bound? You might, Trabbit, you might. Let me remind you, and it was a team that I brought up a week ago doing this very show. And did you see where they were ranked this past week? Guys, don't sleep on SMU. I'm going to be really intrigued to see. SMU should be in the key and operative word. SMU should win the rest of their games. Their only loss is to unbeaten BYU, who again is playing right now in the Holy War. Keep an eye on SMU. It's going to be really, 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 really interesting. And my other apology, Tom just brought it up. I can't believe I'm saying this. Lane Kiffin and Ole Miss. Now, somebody said to me, I have to lay off a Lane Kiffin. No, I don't have to lay off a Lane Kiffin. No, I don't. Not yet. Not yet. I think that Lane Kiffin is somebody that if you pull up his stats, Google is your friend. Yahoo is your friend. If you pull up his coaching record, you will see the same thing that I see. There's nothing there. There's nothing there. I mean, unless you want to call winning the conference while at Florida Atlantic something of great consequence. He sucked in the NFL. He's been meh most places in college football. But give him props today for knocking off Georgia the way they did. Give him props. Got to do it. And now I'm going to do this because you've probably heard me do this bit before. And if you've heard me do this bit, you know what's coming next. Somebody will say, and this, I shit you not. I crap you not. Thank you. It's been a while. I crap you not. Somebody said this to me as I was doing a show at Woodward this past week. I said, there's nothing there on his resume. And he kind of gave me a weird look and he was like, oh, come on, there's something there. And I said, okay, go ahead and tell me. Because I've had this conversation many times. Go ahead and tell me. Where is it? The NFL? He went 4-12 and 1-3 with the Raiders. He did such a crappy job that the Crypt Keeper literally had to do a PowerPoint telling everybody what a disaster he was, the late Al Davis. Then with much ballyhoo, do you remember he went to Tennessee and he was going to turn Tennessee around? Do you know what he did in that one season at Tennessee? He went 7-6, 4-4 in the SEC. And then he went to his dream job at USC. Do you remember that? He went 8-5, 10-2. Now, mind you, they were on probation, 7-6, 3-2. He was such a disaster at USC that his athletic director at the time, Pat Hayden, remember Pat Hayden, met him on the tarmac after a game and fired him on the tarmac. So he went to Florida Atlantic. He went 11-3, 5-7, and 10-3. Now, again, if you want to say that winning Conference USA is something, I guess you got me there. I guess you got me there. And in his time at Ole Miss, 5-5, 10-3, 8-5, 11-2, and now 7-2. Best finish was tied second in the West. For all the chatter, for all the ballyhoo, those are his numbers. That's real. So, no, I'm not ready to anoint Lane Kiffin and say I owe him something because they're not going to win the SEC. But I am willing to say I didn't think you beat him at one of the coolest places you'll ever see a college football game. If you haven't heard me say it before, I'm telling you now. Seriously, you want to take a fun road trip? Go down to Oxford. It'll blow your mind. I'm not joking. And Todd, listen, don't tell anybody. There's like a factory down near Oxford that mass produces hot chicks and sundresses. I don't know where the factory is, but on college game day, another one? It was insane. Now, don't get me wrong. I found myself matriculating into the Grove where all the barbecuing was going on. And they're the nicest people. But it's almost like they can see a Yankee a million miles away. You hungry, Yankee? And they'd give me a big plate of food. But then I'd go, there goes another one. Mass produce hot chicks in sundresses. It's incredible. Shauna just puked up his CC. And Dip saying good things about Kiffin. That's the truth. No idea how he still gets jobs. Dude, there's nothing there. BC, Virginia, and Cal is what SMU has left. Skydog, I stand by it. They should, key and operative word, finish it off. And then it gets interesting. One loss SMU playing one loss Miami in an ACC championship. Now, the question is, do they both get in? I don't know. This is going to be so intriguing, you guys. It really is. Do you remember when we talked about it at the beginning of the year? And I said, there are going to be some really good three-loss teams that don't get in. And in fairness, I thought Michigan would be a three-loss team this year. And I said, I don't think they're going to get in. And my reasoning was because of who they lose to. If they lose to Texas, if they lose to Oregon, and they lose to Ohio State, well, those are going to be three teams that get in over them. And then you have to remember there's going to be the at-large. And then there's going to be, you know, the multiple SEC teams. And yes, the Big 12. And yes, the ACC. So, guys, I underestimated it. Forget good three-loss teams. I think there might be a few good two-loss teams that struggle to get in. That's what I'm worried about. I have said it before. Lane Kiffin markets himself great with a terrible resume. You are 1,000% correct. Props to him, man. He keeps getting great gigs. He's like James Franklin. You know the thing that I will say about Franklin? We were talking about it. At least he can say he mixed in a Big Ten championship, right? I'll take the Big Ten championship over the Conference USA championship. So that's what's going to be very interesting. As Sky Dog said, with Georgia losing, it's starting to happen. You are 1,000% right, man. You are picking up exactly what I'm feeding. Like, there are going to be, I think, forget the three-loss teams. I think there might be some really good two-loss teams that find a way to not get in. It's insane. All right, Notre Dame goes to the playoffs. They will. Now, I want you to think about that. Think about that for just a second. Here's a team that lost to Northern Illinois earlier in the year. What does that loss mean? Nothing. Nothing. Means nothing. It's all right. We can get back on track. It's all right. And that's not a shot against Northern Illinois. You know, you got to remember, I'm a guy, I did broadcasts in the Mid-American Conference. Coach Novak, shout out. Sundresses in SEC country distract Shauner from barbecue. Let this be a lesson for all you kids out there that are considering where to go for college. I'm not joking. There are two places, and Todd, you can ask my buddy Mike this. There's the factory in the Laurentian Mountains, and ask Derek Sanderson, the ex-Bruin, that mass produces brunettes, dark-haired, dark-eyed hotties in Montreal. It's somewhere in the mountains. I don't know where. But it's almost like they turn the machine on at like 6 o'clock at night, and then they all just find their way to Crescent Street. And you're like, my gosh, there's an 11, there's an 11, there's 11. I don't want anything to do with her. She's just a 10. And the same thing down at Oxford. I'm not even joking. If only Michigan cooperated and went at least 9-3. Yeah. And can you imagine how mad you would be? Like, seriously, I mean, here's the crazy thing. Guys, I'm serious. There might be some good two-loss teams that don't make it. That's how crazy this college football season is. Todd, I better do a read. I'm going to tell you guys again, I started early tonight. I want to go watch a holy war, okay? Like, I'm going to, my last remaining energy of the day is going to be spent watching the holy war tonight. Let me tell you about our friends at the Wealth Advantage Group. If you are ready to take charge of your financial future, look no further than the Wealth Advantage Group, located in historic downtown Northville, owned by those two, one of them a Michigan fan, the other a Notre Dame fan with over 20 years of industry experience. That's right, the Husak brothers. They understand that your financial goals are as unique as you are. And that's why they offer personalized expert guidance to help you navigate the complexities of financial planning. Now, whether you're saving for retirement, getting ready to sell your company, or already in retirement, they can help guide you through every step of your financial journey. They work with clients throughout all stages of life. They have clients in over 20 states. Look, the investment world is a complex one, and if you're ready to start taking your finances more seriously, it might be time to work with the experts. Reach out to the Wealth Advantage Group at 248-773-8574. Check out their website at www.thewealthadv.com. legacies.com. More of the fantasy stuff back in August. I said 9-3 gets them in. Casera. Yeah, dude, I thought that they would be out, as you recall, Skydog, because of who they lost to. A loss to Texas all of a sudden goes like this and catapults Texas over them. A loss to Oregon, same. A loss to Ohio State, same. Well, those are three teams. Now there's only nine teams that have to be better. You assume that there's going to be three immediately in the SEC, right? Immediately. You assume that there's going to be one in the Big 12. There's going to be an independent. There's going to be one or two in the ACC and then the at-large. And then all of a sudden, the music playing and you don't have a chair to sit in. It's weird. Andrew said, I'm late. That's okay. I went early. It's not your fault. I'm going to go watch the Holy War. The natives are restless tonight, saying Moore has to go. Does he get another year? I want to ask you guys that. Seriously. Only you Michigan fans can answer that. I'm serious. Only you guys can answer that. Michigan fought hard today. Kirk Campbell is trash. So let me ask you guys. We all knew that this year was going to be a step back. Just the mere fact that people were openly saying 9-3, right? We all knew that they were going to take a step back. This is a catastrophic step back. I am, and if I'm overstating that, you guys yell at me. I think this is a catastrophic step back. I do. Many years ago, I said, this is going back to like 2012. I said the bare minimum for a program like Michigan, for a program like Michigan State, the bare minimum should be 8-4. Like the bare minimum. Michigan's going to finish 6-6. You guys know that, right? They should beat Northwestern again. Boy, I just looked at the score, 35-6. Oh, baby. How you doing, BK? They should beat Northwestern. I think we can all say that, right? All right, so Ohio State, anything can happen in a rivalry. I'm sorry. I don't buy that crap. I've never bought that crap. Blah, blah, blah. Ohio State's a better team. All right. So with all that being said, Michigan finishes this season at 6-6. You go to, I was reading the Sporting News the other day. They had Michigan State going to the Detroit Bowl to take on Ohio. They had Michigan going to the Pinstripe Bowl to take on, I believe it was Georgia Tech. Speak of the devil and he shall appear. Georgia Tech, of course, knocked off Miami today. But I believe that was the matchup off the top of my head. I know it doesn't do anything for anybody. I'm still old-fashioned. I love bowl games. I still think it's important for young players, although a lot of those young players are now going to go leave in the transfer portal and all that. I still think it's important to get the extra practices, et cetera, et cetera. But with all that being said, you guys have watched this team this year. I don't think it's fair to judge a new coach in his first season. I don't. I mean, all bets are off if it's a complete disaster. Like if you roll to 2-10 at Michigan or you do something really ugly, all bets are off, right? But I don't think it's fair to judge harshly in a first year. All right. I think you're going to have to show a heck of a lot more. And to me, it's not just the record. It's the how it's happening and how they look and some of the calls and things like that. And as I watch these games and I try my darndest to watch objectively, I hope you guys can all respect me for that. I kind of pat myself on the back for being objective most of the time. I would be very frustrated if I was a Michigan fan because there's a good dose of woulda, coulda, shoulda. And I think today was a really strong example of woulda, coulda, shoulda. This could have been a huge win. And what would it mean at the end of the year? What's the difference between 7-5 and 6-6? Right? I get it. But to knock off previously unbeaten Indiana in their place down in Bloomington, which, by the way, is a pretty cool place, I'm not going to lie. But to knock them off not only gives you confidence into going into Northwestern, you know what it also does? It makes everybody go, maybe could we spoil a parade for Ryan Day this year? Could we do that again? I don't know. Jason said, stop with the fire more crap. I agree. You can't do it this year. You can't. Andrew, no, you can't fire more yet. Sean, is it crazy to see the ex-Jets coach being U of M's coach? Robert Sala? Local guy? I don't know how long he's going to stay out of the game, though. Somebody's going to snoop him up, right? Jason said, everybody had Oregon, Indiana, and Army as the only defeated team so far, right? Jason, you know what that does? That goes right back to the beginning of the season and our college football playoff prognostication, which we all admitted nobody has a clue. This is uncharted territory for all of us. We can put educated guests out there, okay? You know what makes it even more difficult and makes me say, okay, there might be some good two-loss teams that aren't in the playoff? Exactly what you just brought up. Exactly what you just brought up. Oregon, people had them in, right? People knew about Oregon. Most people were saying either Oregon or Ohio State in the Big Ten. Indiana? Army? How do you keep them out? Hey, guys, listen. BYU wins tonight, the Holy War. How do you keep BYU out if they go unbeaten? I'll say it again, SMU. SMU, who has the one loss to BYU, wins out and then knocks off Miami in the ACC. Are you going to go tell SMU to pound sand? The committee won't. I'm telling you right now. Like this year being an anomaly, if that's the right word. Like what Harbaugh going 2-4 in 2020. Possible. I say it again, though. And you guys can fact check me here. Harbaugh was going like this for a couple years. 2024 is when the bottom dropped out. And then obviously he made some changes on the staff. If you want to insert your Connor Stallions joke, go right ahead. It's there. But I think you know what I'm saying. And you know, I know a lot of people close to the program said the light bulb went on. And he was like, okay, you know what? I got to get some guys that can relate to these players. He made some changes and the rest is history. Ryan Day is going to hang 60 on more. I think they are too. I made the joke when I was working with Neil the other day. It might be a good year to get COVID again. Remember how they didn't play? It might be a good year to get COVID again. Just might be. But, I mean, to my point, it is one of those things that, and by the way, you guys, I hope you know, like, I'm not taking anything away from Michigan. You know, I make the little joke. I said it before. You're national champions. Nobody can take it away from you. Period. End of story, right? But it really was one of those things where, if you remember, they went from 8-5 to 10-3, where they were 8-1 in conference, and then all of a sudden you're 9-4 and you're 6-3 in conference. And then all of a sudden you're 2-4 and obviously 2-4 in conference and everything. So it was almost like the shine was coming off. And remember, there was all the talk of buying him out. He made a lot of changes, and props to them. They ended up winning the Big Ten. But I think we're at a point now. I know you're frustrated. I can't blame you. I get it. Actually, I can blame you. You won a national championship last year, man. Come on now. But I think it's more the coach of the future. What's up, David? Is more the coach of the future. And yes, this year is really easy to deal with when you sleep on that natty pillow. No doubt about it. But that's what has me interested right now. By the way, quick look at the scoreboard. Boy, what a disaster for Florida State. 52-3, Notre Dame's up. Alabama's stretch it to 35-6. Oklahoma has taken the lead. 23-16 on Missouri late in that one. Penn State all over Washington. Virginia with a 21-19 lead over Pitt. Holy war in the first quarter, no score yet. Ohio State knocks off Purdue 45-0. As I mentioned, Georgia Tech with the upset of Miami. Texas rolled all over Florida. Ole Miss with the 28-10 win over Georgia. So, and Army remains unbeaten. Colorado wins again. What do you do about Colorado? Colorado wins that conference with one of the most impactful players in college football. Do you keep a two-loss Colorado out? I don't think so. I think they get in. I really do. I think they get in. Bo went from 6-6 in 84, I think, to 10 or 11 wins in 85 in a number two ranking. Yes. But Sky Dog, I know how important taking care of business is. If you remember, they didn't win the Big Ten that year. They went 10-1-1. They lost to Iowa on a last second field goal. And you can fact check me. I think they tied Illinois that year. But that was one of the best. That was one of the best Michigan squads I had seen. And in 84, they lost their starting quarterback, a guy by the name of Jim Harbaugh. Broke his arm. And I think they had to finish the season with Chris Zerbrug. Was that his name? Chris Zerbrug? But it seemed like it was going one way. You know what I mean? I mean, the difference was Bo had won multiple Big Ten championships before then. And it seemed like the Harbaugh thing was kind of coming down. You know, after the darn good 2015 and then the really good 2016, it kind of like, uh-oh, is this going in the other direction? And then obviously you took off from there. LSU couldn't get a thing moving at all. David, I talked about it earlier. It was funny to watch and watch BK lose his mind on the sideline. That's always funny to see. And as Sky Dog said, no, especially if Hunter wins the Heisman. You guys, whether you like to hear it or not, you better start talking them up, especially with Cam Ward losing to Georgia Tech today. And fumbling the ball late. When Miami got the ball back, if you remember late in the game, I think a lot of people probably said, here they go again, and then Cam Ward fumbles. Dude's going to get some love. I'm just telling you right now. And again, that is not an endorsement. Don't narc on me. I am not saying who I'm voting for or anything like that. I'm just saying that he is a very serious candidate. And if you don't think he's a very serious candidate, you better think twice. Todd, what do you have? Todd, what do you have? Oh, jeez, oh, Pete. Sky Dog, Michigan tied with Iowa, who have them, their one loss, 12-10. They lost to Iowa, Rob Holtland's field goal. And was it Illinois they tied to? Somebody fact check me, 1985. Do I know Moore is going to be the next great Michigan head coach? No, it's too early to tell. Absolutely. I'm with you. I can't. Are there disconcerting things? Absolutely there are. There are a lot of disconcerting things. I'm going to tell you point blank. And if some of you Michigan fans get mad at me for this, so be it. I'm just going to tell you what I see. There are moments he looks lost. Do you guys get that impression? There are moments he looks like eye test lost. Does that make sense? Like the deer in the headlight type of stuff? Oh, yeah, yeah. Let me tell you about Legacy Partners. Did you know that thousands of Metro Detroiters have already called Legacy Partners to get help with their home and auto insurance? Our friends at Legacy Partners are one of Southeast Michigan's top independent insurance agents. They provide a full-service, one-stop solution for all of your insurance needs, personal and business, large and small. Legacy has helped our listeners by fixing mistakes other agents have made, asking the right questions to get the right coverage put in place to properly protect you, and yep, help save you some money at the same time. Isn't that what we all want nowadays? Chances are, if you haven't checked your policies in the last year, you're probably paying too much and you could be underinsured. So what are you waiting for? Give Legacy Partners a chance to help with your home, your cars, life insurance, Medicare enrollment, or your business insurance needs. Call them today at 586-209-4106 or visit legacypartnersins.com to get started with your new quote. So it'll be interesting to see how this new thing shakes out. But can I remind you the same thing that I said in the previous era? And unfortunately, Michigan and Michigan State fans don't need to apply. But I remember making this same conversation and argument to my Michigan friends a few years later because Michigan State fans went through it. Michigan State fans absolutely lost their shit in 2015. If you remember, even after a late season loss, because of where they were ranked. And I'm sorry, I thought it was comedy. I thought it was comedy. And my reasoning was this. So Ohio State was ranked number one, if I'm not mistaken, in the little wacky playoff rankings, right? So if you knock off the number one team, what might that do to your ranking? Furthermore, if you knock off the number one team and you're still not in the top four, say you're six, or say for the sake of an argument, they were, you're five. You're going to the Big Ten championship, right? You won the division. Who is unbeaten and ranked at number four? Iowa. What do you think is going to happen there? Well, and as you guys recall, that's exactly what happened. Nobody thought they'd go into Columbus and win. They beat them in Columbus. Remember Geiger? And then they won on that epic drive against Iowa. Well, what do you... Of course they're going to leapfrog them. Right? And that's what I told people. The people that watch this stuff and lose their mind. Dude, wake up. Now, I admit it. I love watching it. It is a made-for-television presentation. They suck me in. I just don't put a lot into it because there are future games played. There's an opportunity for you to make up your ground if you're in the shooting, it's shouting distance. And that's what I told my friends from Michigan back in 2021. Hey, guys, if you beat Ohio State that last game of the year, I really like your chances of getting into the playoff. So the people that, like, lose their mind, I don't know. What are we doing? Like, come on. But, I mean, I guess that's the fun part, if you will, of this situation. But I just don't think you get too worked up over it. Sky Dog said, what about Vandy's quarterback? He hasn't been mentioned that much for what it was. That last 28 seconds didn't help my resolve, but 1 year after being gutted like they were, too premature to boot him. I agree. Not yet. Got to cut my dog a pork chop up. Ooh, lucky dog. M got the better bowl that year, from Nick. Or are you talking about, that was 2011. Remember that? They got the BCS bowl. They went and played Virginia Tech. Yeah, that was 2011. 2015 is when Michigan State went to the playoff and ended up getting crucified by Alabama. But people were losing their mind. And I was like, guys, relax. You still have Ohio State. If you beat Ohio State in Columbus, okay, you're going to skyrocket. They did. They didn't skyrocket highly enough. Oh, I can't believe it. We're behind Iowa. Well, two things. Number one, Iowa hasn't lost yet. Number two, do you know who you're playing in the Big Ten championship if you find a way to beat Penn State at home? You're playing Iowa. And Michigan State didn't, not only did they leapfrog Iowa, they went from 5 to 3. That was crazy. Thank you. Skydog fact checked me. Yeah, I was right. Illinois. They tied Illinois 3-3, lost to Iowa 12-10. That was one of the best Michigan teams I ever saw, though. That team was loaded in 85. Even though they didn't win the Big Ten, went to Fiesta Bowl. They beat Nebraska that year, I think. Good stuff. He's a bum on a Cinderella shoe. Are you with it, Dave? Are you with me? I would have concerns if I was a Michigan fan. Like, I'm not saying you shouldn't have concerns, but I don't know. I've always been the type, unless it's a pure unmitigated disaster, I can't imagine firing a guy in year one. Now, I don't believe in prolonging. I don't believe in prolonging the inevitable. I think if you figure out the guy isn't the guy, all right, in year two, all bets are off. I know some people go, you can't fire a guy after 2 years. You have to show me something by the end of 2 years. In the first year, I'm going to give you a pass, but you have to show me something. You have to show me something in year two. If you don't show me anything and you roll through another 6-6 or 7-5 season, at that point in time, I'm saying my standards are higher than that. Todd, put that back up for just a second. Yeah, all day concerns. I'm with you. Yeah, I was right. They beat Nebraska in the Fiesta Bowl. They lost the Rose Bowl. 87 was the weird year I always tell my son about. And if I'm not mistaken, Indiana beat Michigan that year as well. And late in the Big Ten season, like the big game, remember the big game we all used to look forward to was like the 3:30 game on ABC. The big Ten game, I'm not making this up, kids, was Indiana and Michigan State. It was just a strange year. You had a down Ohio State. You had a down Iowa. And if you remember, Iowa back then was unbelievable. I mean, like national power good. And you had a down Michigan. And the big game was Michigan State and Indiana. And Lorenzo White ran all over them. And Michigan State ended up winning the Big Ten and knocking off USC for the second time that year in the Rose Bowl. So that's the way it went. Yeah, they beat Nebraska 27-22. Michigan has to beat Northwestern to be bowl eligible. According to BK Research, that would make them the first NCAA college football national champion to fail to meet bowl eligibility criteria in the season following their championship. They gone. Didn't Auburn go 6-6 one of those times after winning a championship? Was it Gus Malzahn? I think it was Gus, wasn't it? I think they won the Natty and then they went 6-6 the next year. Michigan's going to beat Northwestern, right? 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 We'll see. So if Indiana beats those who shall not be named, that's an Oregon IU big championship with that team and the James Franklin looking from the outside. Yeah. Yeah. Right? Yeah. Could you imagine that? Unbeaten Oregon taking on unbeaten Indiana for the Big Ten championship. Could you imagine that? Two-loss Ohio State? Are they in trouble at that point in time under that scenario? I don't know. Utah just scored at 7-3. Thank you. Yeah, Blake Ezor came a couple years later. That year was Lorenzo. Lorenzo White was phenomenal. Low White was absolutely phenomenal. I mean, huge sophomore year in 85, and then 87, he was just an absolute beast, man. It's 42-6 now. Alabama over LSU down in Baton Rouge. Can I smile? Am I allowed to smile over that? Todd, I swear to God, this is not a window into my soul. I am not usually somebody that gets a lot of happiness out of somebody's grief. I'm going to make an exception for BK. I just am. Sorry. And if you want to put the video up of him dancing, I think a lot of other people would probably feel that same way. It's one of the creepiest videos, him doing this stuff behind his prize recruit. Low White was so good. Boy, he was. Somebody said that would, but that team at two losses and James Franklin at one loss. Wouldn't that be interesting? Under that scenario, like I said, I mean, all of a sudden, say what you want, but James Franklin only has one loss. Ohio State has two. Granted, both to unbeaten teams. What do you do? Does somebody say they think Ohio State's better because their two losses were the unbeaten teams? So that's what makes this so interesting about college football season. Skydeck said, reason I say that because I think Florida State ended the regular season undefeated. I still 100% feel horrible for Florida State last year. I do. I feel horrible for them. They lose their quarterback late in the year, and that's what cost them. An injury cost them. I mean, that's what the committee said. Hey, congratulations. You had a fantastic year, but we have to judge this on who we think is best because your quarterback is out. I cried when Lil White and the Spartans won that epic Rose Bowl. I was 12. Dude, it was unbelievable. Seriously, it was unbelievable. Hey, let me tell you about Lindsay Broadwell. When it's time to get yourself a new house, whether you're buying, selling, or both, you need to contact the right agent. Who do we recommend here? Well, there she is, Lindsay Broadwell. Your house is probably the biggest investment you'll ever make, and that's why you need a pro. Lindsay grew up on the mean streets of Northville and has expanded her team all over Southeast Michigan. She's an expert in all facets of the business. And when it's time to move, our friend Lindsay and her team will make sure you get the most out of your house and everything goes smoothly when finding your new home. Buyer, seller, first-time buyer, doesn't matter. Make sure you contact Lindsay at BroadwellHomes.com. She will help you with everything from start to close. Licensed realtor at Real Broker LLC. Start your search today at BroadwellHomes.com. So yeah, this is going to be fun, guys. And I want to say this again. I hope I'm not coming across as a know-it-all, because you know what, or trying to be, I don't know. I said it at the beginning of the year. I don't know. Neither do you. That's the one thing we're on page for. I can use some deductive reasoning and say all the people that were handing out, you know, playoff passes to teams left and right, I thought you were out of your mind. I told you, I talked to somebody who told me, oh, there's no doubt in my mind the Big Ten's going to get five teams in. And I was like, huh? The math doesn't add up. Because you know they're going to try to cram in as many SEC teams as they can. They're going to get a Big 12 team in. They're going to get an ACC team or two in. They're going to get that at large. You know, the math didn't add up. Well, where are all these numbers going to come from? In my mindset, again, just to reiterate why I didn't have all the answers. My mindset was, I think there are going to be some good 9-3 teams that are going to be sitting at home. Well, shit, the way things are going right now, there are going to be some good 2-loss teams that are sitting at home. There's a distinct possibility of that when you look at some of these things. Oh, David, thank you for the kind words. That's nice. Sean, you the man to me in college football. Thank you. I love it. And you know your crap as well. That's why I've always enjoyed talking to you. Somebody said Lions -3.5 tomorrow night is our new DE acquisition playing this week. I would think so, right? I would think so. That's a trap game tomorrow. I don't care what you guys say. I don't care what anybody says. Do I think that the Lions are going to win? Yes, I do. I do. I think the Lions are going to win, but I think that's a trap game. The one thing that we have to get used to as Lion fans is now everybody gets up for us, right? Primetime at home. Houston's not a bad team. I know that they've looked meh a little bit. I watched that Vikings game earlier this year, and I was like, what the hell's wrong with Houston? And then I started to think, maybe it wasn't a Houston problem. Maybe it was a Minnesota problem. They looked terrible, right? They looked terrible. Auburn followed their natty with an 8-5 season. Which one? Was that Gus's year? Because wasn't there a couple? And gosh, I wanted to say one of those years, they finished 6-6. Was it the 2010? See, now, all right, talk to me. 2011, they finished 8-5. And then let's see, 2000 and was that 13? I'm going to look it up right now. Just stick with me. Talk amongst yourselves, okay? Dude, 2013 in Malzahn's year, they went and lost to Florida State, if you remember, 34-31. And the next year, they also went 8-5. So, yeah, I mean, you watch Auburn fall off the map a couple times. And I know a couple times, see, I'm going to look it up right now. Didn't Gus Malzahn kind of become the king of the 6-6 for a while there, too? Let me see. Yeah. How about the one where he's going like this? He's doing like the Batman dance. It's so creepy. Yeah, 12-2, 8-5, 7-6, 8-5, 10-4, 8-5, 9-4, 6-5. The Gus Malzahn yo-yo, man. Jeez, oh, Pete. Somebody said Michigan won the Natty, and now the Lions are a Super Bowl contender. Well, the world is ending. Yeah, dude, let me tell you something. Honestly, I know we're not supposed to feel this way because we're Lions fans. You are lying to yourself. Absolutely, positively lying to yourself if you haven't accepted they're one of the best teams in the NFL. You are simply basing it on nothing more than the past as opposed to this year. 2012, they went 3-9. Yeah, that's what brought Gus Malzahn in, because if you remember, then they went to the national championship game, because that was the year when I was out in Pasadena. I remember talking to Florida State fans, and I kid you not, it was, speaking of bizarro world, I was talking to these Florida State fans, and they were going, well, thank God you guys are here playing in the Rose Bowl. We want nothing to do with you. Drove me out of my mind. Look at that. How embarrassing is that? Gene Chizik. Yep. It was, who can forget the great Gene Chizik era? That was a fun team, though. Cam Newton's team. That team was a fun team, man. They, like, all jokes aside, that was a fun team. All right, now I got to look that up. You guys get me going. I got to look at Chizik's year by year. 8-5, 14-0, 8-5, 3-9. Come on, man. Come on, he hasn't been a head coach since. It's amazing how that works itself out. When people say that I respond with the Pittsburgh Steelers when Chuck Knoll showed up, it's incredible. You don't say it enough. Like, Chuck Knoll to Bill Cowher to a guy that, in my mind, doesn't get anywhere near the respect that he should. And I'm serious when I say that. Mike Tomlin, you know they're always going to be in it. They are. And it's not easy in the National Football League. It just seems like they're always in it. But, I mean, you're talking about what? 50 some odd years, and they've had three coaches? Like, are you kidding me? Brian Kelly doing the Travolta Pulp Fiction dance is super cringe. It's just, and from the Batman, remember when Batman did that stupid dance with the fingers? Ugh, it's just very, very creepy. Skydog said, I feel like Michigan is safe from that. Be careful. That's all I'm going to say to you. Be careful. And I know you've listened to me long enough to remember this, and I still hear from people that brought this up. Back in 2010, Todd, true story. Back in 2010, I made a time machine joke, and this is before things really got bad, right? I made a time machine joke, and I said, you know, if I jumped in a time machine and went back to September of 1969. And I told people, hey, guys, you know this new coach at Michigan? I know you're all struggling with his last name, but I just came from the future. And this guy is going to own Michigan State, and he is really going to put Michigan football back on the national map. Do you know what people would have said to me in 1969? They would have laughed at me. Michigan State was a power. Michigan wasn't. And then I remember having that conversation when I think some of us were like, all right, this D'Antonio guy is pretty good. And this Rich Rod experience isn't working, which, by the way, let me say again for the record, I always like to admit I was wrong because not a lot of people in my business do it. I have no problem doing it. I'm not going to get everything right. I was terrified of Rich Rod at Michigan. Terrified. Terrified. I openly admit it. Until I saw how stubborn he was. Like his insistence that he could win with that defense in the Big Ten is one of the most moronic things I've seen in my lifetime. And what makes it worse were all the people that used to call into my radio show and say, you don't know what you're talking about. You don't know football. We'll be fine with the 3-3-5. Yeah, and the Big Ten. Oh, yeah. Nobody predicates anything on running the ball. Yeah, it'd be fine. It'll be fine. But I remember like telling people back then, I said, what if we're in this weird era right now where the script was flipped? And honest to God, I didn't come from the future. Little did I know that that was the era where, you know, Michigan State would win multiple divisions, multiple Big Ten conferences, and have that streak over Michigan. I never in a million years did I think that. But I just said, you know, what if? Come on, man. This is so moronic. How long is Moore's rope? My guess is next year. If you see a lot of the things that you're seeing this year, and you, again, you guys tell me, I've had a couple of you agree with me tonight. If you're seeing a lot of the things you're seeing this year, including the deer in the headlight looks and some of the quizzical calls, it might be next year, honestly. I mean, that's, to me, I think it gets to a point where at some point in time, you have to say, this just isn't working. And I remember going back and forth with a lot of people. Remember the whole Rich Rod got better every year thing? It was moronic. It really was. It was moronic. I guess if you want to look at overall record, but I would always remind people, hey guys, he lost his, what was it, last four games in his last season? And each game was a blowout that was progressively worse. Like they lost by 20, then they lost by 25, then they lost by 30 or whatever. And I remember just saying to people, come on, you guys, stop it. Like knock it off, right? I don't know. We'll see. All right, listen, I got to go watch this game, dude. I can't believe I went an hour. I told Todd, I'm not going to go an hour. I'm only going to go half hour because I have to go and watch the Holy War. And then I start bullshitting with you guys, and here we are. All right? You know I love every second of it. Thank you, guys. Virginia on top of Pitt, 24-19. BYU with a 10-7 lead now over Utah. The Cougs with a 14-7 lead over the Aggies from Utah State. Let me see. Kansas ends up knocking off Iowa State, Colorado over Texas Tech, Oregon pulled away from Maryland. That was tight for a little while. 42-13, Alabama over LSU. Oh, darn. Shucks and rats. The Holy War. I want to watch BYU, Utah. It's one of those, there are certain rivalries I just kind of like. That's one of them. I enjoy that game, especially this year. I think the stakes are so high this year. I mean, BYU is legitimately playing for a playoff spot, right? Utah would love nothing more than to knock their Mormon friends off and improve their chances of getting in a better bowl. Hey, All About Catering is a full-service caterer. Graduations, weddings, bridal showers, corporate events, anything you need catering for, from 25 to 4,000 people, All About Catering can and will take care of you. They've taken care of me and my family. They will take care of you and your family. Customer service and satisfaction is their number one goal. So do not sweat your next big event. Just go to allaboutcateringllc.com today to see their menus and all their five-star reviews. Give them a call, 586-731-1398, to get your event started. Rick and his crew will take care of you. They took care of me. All right, so I got to get out of here. I'm going to watch a game. You guys enjoy the game. Thanks so much for joining us. Todd, thank you as always. Go Lions. Can't wait for the game tomorrow night. We'll talk again with Shep on Monday. See you, bye.
Off the Air with Sean Baligian. Executive produced by Sean Baligian and Todd Losey. Theme song, incidental music, and related sound effects are from Play It Loud by Jam Studio. Engineering, mixing, and graphic design support provided by the Unsyndicated Podcast team. Don't forget to like and subscribe on all your favorite channels. While you're there, be sure to rate and review the podcast. Got something to say to Sean? Call the Unsyndicated Hotline at 248-237-3257.